2023 is nearly into the fourth quarter as August is upon us. Your U.S. Army Corps of Engineers continues to work and deliver projects and programs for our nation. In this month's episode of Corps Connection, the St. Paul District recently performed modifications to its Pool 2 Wing Dam in Hastings, Minnesota. The Jacksonville District takes us to Puerto Rico, where they are working on several projects in the U.S. territory, and our Engineering Research and Development Center's Geotechnical and Structure Laboratory is looking into advanced manufacturing technology to develop new material systems for use in both civil and military applications. Those stories coming up in this edition of Corps Connection. Once again, welcome to Corps Connection. I'm your host, Patrick Bloodgood. We start this month's program in Minnesota, where the St. Paul District completed a $324,000 modification to the Pool 2 Wing Dam. The modification is the first ecosystem project in the nation to be awarded under the Navigation and Ecosystem Sustainability Program.
Hello, my name is Mitchell Kenegendorf, and I am a contracting officer representative, a COR for the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. My job is to make sure that the contractor is not cutting any corners and to make sure that the taxpayers have a quality product. Behind me is Pool 2, and we just completed notching 17 wing dams. These wing dams were created back in the late 1800s, and they were used to raise the Mississippi River level to 4.5 feet. With the installation of our lock and dam system, we doubled that, making it from 4.5 feet to 9 feet, making our wing dams going from partially to almost completely submerged. Even though these things have been a hazard for our boaters, they've also been a really big home for our fish and a really big enjoyable to the fishermen. So, to help improve navigation, but also protect our environment, the Corps of Engineers created a long-term and dual-purpose initiative called the Navigation and Ecosystem Sustainability Program, or NESP for short. And this is the first NESP project, and we notched 17 wing dams all the way through South St. Paul Park down to Spring Lake. And these wing dam notches were about 40 to 100 feet long. And what we did with the rock that we notched or removed is we placed it adjacently downstream or on top of the leftover existing dam structure. A little bit more about my job is I just love being outside and being able to actually see the things that we've designed. Being able to put everything from paper onto the ground while also being able to talk to other people from the community or just contractors that have a lot of experience. And overall, while I'm doing that, I'm also making sure that, you know, we are having a product that is environmentally friendly, but also very helpful to the people around.
The notches modified the channel to provide suitable habitat for channel catfish, white or yellow bass, walleye, and paddlefish. Turning our attention to Puerto Rico, the Jacksonville District is working on multiple projects in the territory. They highlight those efforts in this next story.
The U.S. Army Corps of Engineers Jacksonville District and Tills Area Office continues to make progress on its flood risk management projects around the island of Puerto Rico. USAID's project managers at the Puerto Rico Integrated Project Office continues to provide engineering solutions to some of the nation's toughest challenges to reduce the risk of flooding, save lives, and preserve properties to the communities of Puerto Rico.
So the exciting part about what we've been doing to date is that every project that we've completed, there's already been realized benefits. For example, in Rio Puerto Nuevo, all the lower segments of the project that we've already completed, there's residences that are already feeling the benefits of it. There's a reduction of flood. As we continue to complete these projects over the next 5 to 10 years, you're going to continue seeing the reduction of flood risk. You're going to see an improved quality of life. You're going to see more businesses pop up, and you're really going to just have an overall better feel to the city of San Juan and all the other towns that we have our projects in.
The Rio Puerto Nuevo Flood Risk Management Project is a massive project with 12 active contracts, all of which seek to improve one of the most densely populated areas in San Juan.
Yeah, Rio Puerto Nuevo, I mean, once completed, this project really improves overall San Juan. You're reducing flood risk to the area. You're inviting businesses to come in. You're inviting residents to want to live on, alongside the river.
The Rio de la Plata Flood Risk Mitigation Project is located in the town of Dorado and Toa Baja, and it's looking to soon celebrate the completion of articulated concrete block mat and tow key installation and the diversion of the river into the new channel.
This project is important because the Rio de la Plata, it causes significant flooding in the town of Dorado and in the town of Toa Baja. What we're going to do is we're going to widen the channel, we're deepening it, and we're going to realign the river, and we're also building levees on either side of the river. This way we're protecting both municipalities. About 160,000 people will be protected. Right now we're excavating what will be part of the new channel, and at the end of the summer we're going to open that so that water can flow through, and that's what we're calling the river diversion. So sometime at the end of the summer we're going to be celebrating this important milestone in the project.
The Caño Martín Peña Ecosystem Restoration Project is a 3.75-mile long tidal channel located within the San Juan Bay National Estuary in Puerto Rico. It is the only tropical estuary within the National Estuary Program.
It's a restoration project in the heart of a heavily populated area in the middle of San Juan. It's about community, partnerships, organization on the ground, equity, hope, and as of today, action.
In the early 20th century, unauthorized development triggered ecological degradation within the estuary, which affected the socioeconomic conditions of the communities surrounding it.
Very happy and emotional because I know the hard work that this has taken for the communities. They were with the Corps engineers. You know, we've been working with the Corps for the past over 10 years. There have been some highs and lows, but these latest years have been so many achievements, like the approval of the feasibility report in 2016 and now the PPA, definitely signifies how this project has become a priority for the agency and also a priority within Puerto Rico's government.
The restoration of the Caño Martín Peña will reestablish the tidal connection between the San Jose Lagoon and the San Juan Bay.
I have a strong belief in the core mission. I have a strong belief in the projects in Puerto Rico. I have a strong belief that the people of Puerto Rico are going to benefit from these projects. So I hope to continue to working on this mission that that is intended to protect the people of Puerto Rico.
Reporting for USAIS from San Juan, Puerto Rico, this is Jennifer Garcia Torres.
Looking to the future. The Engineering Research and Development Center is continuing to work and develop new material systems, particularly in the area of 3D printing, to create material properties for military engineering and civil works applications that couldn't otherwise be created. We take a look at those efforts.
So the focus area of the group I lead here at the Engineering Research and Development Center is focused on advanced manufacturing techniques or additive manufacturing techniques and leveraging those techniques for the development of new material systems. So most people that work in additive manufacturing focus mostly on like either complex geometry systems or things that you can't make through traditional manufacturing. A lot of what we do here internally at RDEC is development of new material systems. So creating things through additive that you couldn't create otherwise that have interesting material properties. So things like extremely high hardnesses or things that may be functionally graded and deform in particular design manners. So a lot of material by design type work. Some of the specific projects I'm working on here at RDEC deal with leveraging advanced manufacturing techniques to either develop these new material systems or scale them up into large focus areas. So one of the cool things about RDEC is we don't a lot of times deal with little small things. Our mission hats are either civil works infrastructure, which is very large components, or even on the military engineering side, a lot of those applications are very large in nature. So whether it's infrastructure or moving troops from one place to the other, it's all about big, large things. So instead of a lot of the small, tiny trinkets that you deal with traditionally through additive, we're developing a lot of really large things. So pushing the envelope of what can be done with large scale additives. So on the metal side, that may be going through and looking at either bridge or railway steel repair using additive manufacturing techniques, or going through and developing new large scale polymer components that have strength values close to those of like aluminum alloys and things of that nature. So really trying to push the envelope and what those large scale things can be using additive technologies. So some of the applications we work on here at RDEC are mainly twofold. So on the military engineering side, we have a lot of work that focuses on, say, impact kinetics, so things, ballistics, or maybe we need high strength material systems or something of that nature. So a lot of times we're focused on developing new material systems specific to like high hardness and things of that nature. The beauty of that though, is that a lot of those same material systems that we develop on the high hardness side for military engineering are also great in the wear performance standpoint. So they can also be leveraged on the civil works infrastructure side for high wear, fatigue, or for surfaces and things like that. The drivers for making this research important can be twofold depending on the mission space that you're looking at. So on the military engineering side, it's all about increasing your protection factor. So if we can take material systems and increase their hardness or their overall strength of that particular material system, maybe we can use less of it. So maybe we can decrease the weight by still holding true to the same performance factor. On the civil works infrastructure side, a lot of that has to do with lead time. So when you talk about the same component being made from a cast part 18 to 72 months, that's a non-start. So you can't have a waterways navigation structure down for 18 to 72 months because you have a critical component that can't be fabricated. So when you change and you can now fabricate those on demand in a couple of weeks as opposed to months or years, it really changes the paradigm of what can be done.
That does it for the August edition of Core Connection. We'll be back next month to once again highlight the efforts of your U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. Until then, I'm Patrick Bloodgood, and this is Core Connection.